Literally, as we're recording this, Donald Trump's second impeachment process is underway. By the time you're seeing it, it will have concluded. And with Trump being impeached once again and an uncertain future for the process in the Senate, although I have my suspicions, the question remains, what happens to the GOP going forward? And joining us to discuss is columnist for The Nation, Sasha Abramsky. Welcome to the Damage Report.
Hey, good to be here.
Good to have you here. You recently wrote an article, the GOP is no longer a viable governing party, which when I saw it, I thought, my first thought was yes, and my second thought was, I feel like that's been true for a while. But I am curious about your thoughts about the GOP going forward as we transition out of Trump being their official elected leader. I'm curious what you think his role in the party will be.
Yeah, look, I think that the GOP has had this slide towards extremism that massively predates Trump. You can take it back, certainly at least as far as Newt Gingrich in the early 1990s. But there has been a sort of operating idea that the more you rhetorically throw bombs, the better your political chances. And so the Republican Party reinvented itself over a sort of decades long process. Instead of being a sort of calm and steady party, it became a party of insults, a party of hyperbole, a party of sort of increasing extremes. And Trump sort of is the logical endpoint of that. Because what you see in Trump is the bringing together. You have the business interests who've always liked the Republicans because they like tax cuts and deregulation. But then you have the increasingly extreme fringe, the QAnon people, the people who advocate militias, the people who believe that any and every kind of gun control is sort of one world communism. And Trump brings all of that together. And increasingly, you've had this sort of coalition that makes no sense. So a party that includes Mitt Romney, who I don't agree with, but he's a perfectly credible, serious politician. And then a party that includes Donald Trump. And now a party that includes that man in antlers and tattoos who rampaged through the Capitol. So how on earth does that party make sense anymore? And if you look at what's happening in the impeachment debate, which I was watching before coming onto this show, you're seeing one Republican after another basically kissing the ring. They're saying, maybe there was an insurrection, maybe there was some treason going on, but you're rushing to judgment in any way. We don't like Black Lives Matter. I mean, the sort of ability to deflect is quite extraordinary. And so that's why I wrote this article, does the GOP has a future as a governing party? Because it seems to me it doesn't. It seems to me it's fragmenting before our eyes into this politics of overt extremism, sort of flirtation with fascism. And that doesn't leave moderates in the party anywhere to go apart from out.
Okay, there's a lot of things I want to talk about off of that. The first though,
I apologize for sort of going on there.
No, there's just so much there. So you're right, they're kissing the ring. I guess I want your opinion. For what exact reason? So are they kissing the ring because they genuinely agree and believe? Are they kissing the ring because they think Trump supporting a particular politician going forward will be important and they want to be that one? Are they kissing the ring because they think Trump himself will be running again and they want to keep in his good graces when he becomes president again in 4 years? Why do you think they're showing so much loyalty to him even after the attack in the Capitol?
I think a few things. One of them is fear that Trump is very good, as we've seen, at whipping up a mob, and that mob is scary. So the first thing is that there are a lot of politicians who looked at what happened to Lindsey Graham, for example, in the airport the other day when he was mobbed by Trump supporters, and they just don't want to go down that road, and they're sort of trying to personally duck and cover. The other thing is, and I don't know how else to say this, but if you look at the parade of GOP speakers in the House today, a lot of these guys are really, really stupid human beings. And I think they don't recognize the magnitude of the moment. I don't think they have any ability to understand the sort of deep philosophy that underpins democracy. These guys basically went into politics as a smash and grab operation. It was good for them. It gave them a little bit of influence, a little bit of power. Perhaps they could give their cronies a little bit of influence and power. But these aren't political philosophers or scholars, and they just are not intellectually up to the magnitude of the moment. And I think, when the history books are written, we'll see that there was this slide toward mediocrity and this sort of degradation of our civics process in the 1990s and early 2000s. And this is the culminating endpoint. So you have people like Matt Gaetz, who, you know, Matt Gaetz shouldn't be in charge of a dog catcher's office, let alone hold a senior role in Congress. The man is a vile human being. He's really, really inflammatory. He's also a really stupid human being. And when you watch people like that sort of try and give cover to Donald Trump, I think it shows you, you know, exactly what kind of moral crisis this country's in. Mm-hmm. That even when the president promotes insurrection, a large number of his followers actually don't understand fully what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Well, I agree. The slide of mediocrity, there are people being elected that I can't conceive of succeeding 10 years ago. But I want to tie it back to something that you said earlier, because you said, you know, we can talk about, we can trace the beginnings of this movement towards Trump, but you also labeled Trump as the natural endpoint. But I guess my question is he actually the endpoint, or is he just another step along the way? Like, hypothetically, would a president, you know, there's different groups of crazies and those who are mediocre. Like, if, you know, hypothetically, Madison Cawthorn or Lauren Boebert or Marjorie Taylor Greene, like these people who believe in satanic pedophiles drinking the blood of children, if they were to become president, or a slightly different group, the Ted Cruz's and the Josh Hawley's, who have also been in lockstep with the president during all of this, are they not worse in your mind, hypothetically, than Trump himself?
Yeah, I mean, look, Trump is awful. But you look at the trajectory that parts of the Republican Party are on, or the more extreme groups outside the Republican Party, and clearly there are people even more fanatical than Donald Trump. There are clearly people born and raised now in the culture of QAnon, and there are clearly people who have no fealty to democracy at all. Not all of them, but certainly some. When you were listening to some of the GOP Congress members, they don't care about democracy. They care about raw political power. So yes, Trump could just be a sort of staging post on the way to a complete collapse of our civic systems. But I guess what I'm saying when I say he's the logical endpoint, he is the logical endpoint if our country is to remain a democracy. You can't get more extreme than Donald Trump within the democratic context. And you know, you look at what Trump's doing, you look at who he's flirting with, you look at the neo-Nazi groups that he's siding with, you look at the sort of Aryan Nation, all these supremacist groups that now see themselves as part of the Trump coalition. And Trump called them the other day special people. He said, "We love you." You know, he went out of his way to make it abundantly clear that they were the core of his political base. So yes, it's entirely possible politics gets even uglier. It's entirely possible that Trump, when he's booted out of office and probably convicted, and you know, my guess is he'll never be allowed to run for public office again, he'll reinvent himself as a far-right sort of icon. He'll reinvent himself on the fringes of the internet, and he was trying to do so today and apparently was discouraged by Kushner. But he's going to reinvent himself on web platforms that are so extreme and so fanatical that they don't in any way, shape or form accept or abide by the democratic norms. But will the Republican Party go down that road? I don't think so. I think this is Mitch McConnell, you know, for all his other faults, the one thing Mitch McConnell is good at is he's ruthless. He knows how to get rid of somebody when he wants to get rid of somebody. Trump is of no use to McConnell anymore. And I think McConnell is going to do everything he can to rally the center of the Republican Party away from Trumpism towards something else. It may not be something particularly pleasant, but I think Trumpism as a mainstream, main party ideology probably played itself out in this sort of horrific actions of the last few days. I don't see how the Republican Party leadership in the Senate, the House is a different story, but in the Senate, I don't see how they can stick with Trump or why they would want to stick with Trump after what happened.
For more political news, breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.